Welcome back. Thank you for watching Urban TV. We continue our conversation with Pastor Nicholas Wafula. He is a renowned churchman in East Africa and Africa and Uganda as a whole. He started the Deliverance Church in Uganda, and it has grown into this big, denomination, Christian denomination in the country. And we are sharing with him today about marriage and family. We know marriage and family today are one of those key topics that people engage in, because things don't seem to get get right for most people. So we want to pick on his mind and see how best we can handle our families and marriages to ensure that they work for us and our lives, as you know, we continue living on this planet. And as he said, he will be celebrating 50 years in marriage come April, and that is not, you know, just an easy journey. It's not something that most people achieve so easily. So this is a great achievement for Pastor Nicholas Wafula. And Pastor, I was asking you how you managed to keep your marriage going for these 50 years, and you said it was Jesus, first of all, and then you had to love each other, and then you had to be so forgiving to make sure that this marriage works, because none of you is an angel anyway. So I'm just wondering, you give us these three pillars to sustain the marriage. So are these three pillars missing in today's generation? If you look at the current generation, do we lack Jesus? Do we lack God? Is that affecting, you know, our unions, be it maybe even girlfriend or boyfriend, husband and wife, you know? Are we not loving enough of our partners, and are we not a forgiving generation?
Well, I think that is a personal question to every couple that is hearing your question, and they can only be able to answer for themselves how it applies to them. But I want you to say that a few factors probably that have precipitated to the state we are in. And I'm afraid to say perhaps one of the areas of conflicts has been materialism. You end up, you're saying, I'm marrying Jackie and we shall live together. And you're not just looking at Jackie, you're looking at her job and how much she earns. She could be driving, okay?
Right.
And then when you get married, Jackie loses the job.
And the car.
And the car also goes.
And the house.
So, and so what you married has gone, and so your love for her will just go with those things. Now, let me just say this. When we were young, before we got married, I said we were the second group in the church. Yes. We had what we used to call three kinds of love. Mm. One is, I love you because. Okay? You love somebody maybe because of the way they look. We love somebody because of the way they walk.
Mm-hmm.
They love somebody because of what they and so on. Now, that because, if that because you loved goes away, mm-hmm. the love also do what?
It goes.
Will disappear.
Okay.
Then the second one is, I love you. I will love you if. So the other one is because. This one is what?
If.
I love you if. That means there's a condition you need to fulfill for me to continue loving you. And there's love which is based on that. Those two are conditional love. And I think the young men, I don't want to accuse them, the young men and the younger women tend to look at this if and because more than the main kind of love, which according to the Bible, we call it agape love. You love somebody in spite of who he is or she is. In spite of what she is, in spite of how whatever has happened, you still continue loving. I think a spirit of materialism and a conditional love in marriage has, I think, caused the problem.
How can we attain that agape love? Because you say we are now in I love you if and because. We are so focused on those two because it gives us something. Because you're beautiful. If I can get a house from you, I will love you. But we are forgetting the agape love. So how do we get to just love minus attaching conditions to it? If we can draw examples from you.
I don't think there's a way, there's a school where you can go on the train to do that. I think it should come from deep down your heart. Like with me, you asked me earlier, how did Queen Elizabeth... I mean, it is something that you cannot easily describe. It is there. It is undisturbed. It does not depend on a condition. And for us as Christians, we know that such things have been injected into our lives because of Jesus Christ living in us. So if the young men and the young women who are hearing some of us at this age can take a leaf from us, well and good. Yeah, that will save our marriages, that will save our homes. And I do remember the one of the policies we have as a church. We normally say God first, spouse second, family third, ministry fourth. I'm saying that because sometimes it is the busyness of even us pastors that we get involved in that tends to bring away, to bring us away from the families. We are away from spouses. We are away from the children and so on. Now, the same thing, even with the younger people, work can keep you very busy away from your spouse, and that will cause the love between you to dwindle. Okay? So what I would suggest, let us balance the way we relate. Let us balance how the work relates to the family. How does business relate to us as a couple?
Wow. From what you you say, I might be wrong, but from what I gather, you say that agape love comes with you, the love of Christ in you.
Yes.
And I want to believe that the love of Christ, for most of us, starts from childhood because your parents will perhaps take you to church. Then you learn about, you accept Christ in your life and, you know, you kind of grow into this thing and, you know, eventually you become a believer on your own. So I'm wondering, have the parents perhaps failed this generation? Did they not teach them about this love that if you must get love, this is the journey you should walk and then maybe things will work out? Because now it looks like everything is very dysfunctional.
Yeah, you have made it very easy. Or you have made it sound to most people that if you have Christian parents, it is automatically it's going to be that that you are going to do what? To be
to walk the journey.
To be a Christian and you walk their journey.
And be loving.
I want to say that is not true. We as parents do our best to bring the children up in the fear of God as much as we can. And as we do that, we expect that they are also learning from the actions between us, the love we have between mama and the baba, and so on, and hoping that in the end, they can emulate. But I think just like a teacher, not all students get the highest mark. there are those who fail. So I think there is also the drama there, so that even when you have six children whom you have brought up, you'll find them growing up very different and behaving very differently. So I would not in any way blame the parents per se. But I think the parents play their role, and the children, when they are grown, they should also play their role.
You talk about action. Yeah? You can teach, yes, but your actions should also be teaching.
Yes,
you should be learning.
That's right. That's why I said, as much as I teach my children, they should be watching me. How am I living with my ma? Okay? How am I living with them? Okay? Because I can be saying, love one another, I preach it in the church, but I don't love them at home. When I'm at home, I'm a terror. I'm a scarecrow. Okay? And I think Christian life is basically living the life out. The Bible says, they shall know you by the fruit you produce. Not by talking. No. I can talk, but my talk might be very sweet and very nice, but the actions can be miles away from my talk, and that's not helpful.
Well, interesting.
So all I can say, some people say, well, do what I say, but don't do what I do. That's not the game.
You should do as I do as
you
well.
You should do as I do as well.
So that means
yes.
You have to set the right example.
That's right.
Because if you want me to do as you do and you're doing wrong things,
yes.
Then it just might not work. That's but then there is, I think, a trend lately. We're seeing, it's good to see from action, but there are so many cases cropping up, maybe in the elites, I don't know, maybe even some people who are not very lit, cases of single parenthood. The numbers are getting up there.
Well, can I just unpack that a bit? Because single parenthood can be somebody's a widow, or a single parenthood can be somebody who just said, I'm just going to get my children from anywhere and I live with them.
Uh-huh.
I mean, what do you mean by that?
There is that. Where somebody just wants to get children from somebody and go with these children. They don't want the other partner. They've gotten the children, and that's enough for them. And then there are those who just maybe can't, when they get together, they haven't done the right things. The love has not stayed, so they've gone the separate ways, perhaps so bitter. So doesn't that make learning out of action very difficult, because you're just saying one parent. I could be wrong. Maybe you can learn from one parent. I don't know. But I wanted to hear your view on that. Is it possible for just one parent to show the good example?
Can I say this? That planned single parenthood shouldn't be there. That is me.
Mm-hmm. Why?
Because God expects me, husband and wife, to produce a family. And as a pastor, I normally say, younger people, if you are not ready to get married and produce children, do not do that. Wait until you are ready to do what? To produce the children. Mm. And the single motherhood of just getting children from everywhere, that's not of God. I would totally discourage it.
They're even fathers,
and,
I believe.
Yeah, I would totally discourage it. Mm. But if it is a single life of a widow, that one, I'm sure, with her own experience, with maybe the church and the uncles, he can be able to set an example for the children. Even a single parent can set an example. When we're talking about, let me give this an example that has just come to me. The widow of the husband who was shot by Idi Amin, I mean, the children were young. But I want to tell you, she has brought those children up in the fear of God. Oh. And even one of them is one of our church strong elders.
Remind us of the husband's name once again.
Why Okot?
Okot, yes. He was working as...
with the Minister of Education. I don't know whether it was a PAS or undersecretary or something. Mm-hmm. It was a highly placed person.
Okay.
Yeah. So the mother has really brought this child. And I have seen a number of mothers, single mothers, bringing up children. I have another example of a mother who was single. And the singleness came because of the blasts of the war in Kampala. The husband was killed during the war. Okay. But she has brought up the children in the fear of God. So the single parent can definitely bring up the children in the fear of God. I have too many examples in the church where I serve.
Well, thank you so much, Pastor. We'll take a break. Pastor, you speak about single parents actually being able to raise their children in a loving way, in that they grow up to be like the responsible citizen, the loving person that they ought to be. And you also say to give that love, you really need to have love within you. And even if it starts at a young age, it's not entirely what the parents teach you, but also seeing the actions and learning out of them. So when we come back, we'll continue with more of our conversation with Pastor Nicholas Wafula.